in the club before she even had it. She was 21. I don't see a savage. She wanna be the one. She know I come steady. She wanna hold a gun. If you want it, you can have it.
Hand up. Still young. Hand up. So hey. Hand up. One hand. Remember we was talking about how this was the new Vogue-in last year?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. It's new Vogue-in, man. It's the hood Vogue. It's like Vogue-in for, I guess, straight men? I don't
for
know.
Straight, yeah, I guess. Yeah. I mean, I watched the Cash Cobain video, the weekend video the other day, yesterday, and they was doing all types of dances that
they get crazy. they get crazy with the dance moves.
BlkPrint podcast. We in the building. J5. Josh Pease, of course.
You're back. I feel like we haven't been in this seat in a long time. But I mean, we were just in here two weeks ago.
We were just in here. I think like there's just so much stuff that has happened.
Yeah, it's just been a lot going on, man.
Yeah.
The world needs to. You always think like, oh, at the end of the year, things are going to slow down. They do not slow down.
Especially not for us. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Like we just have so many things that shock and surprise us. So we're going to talk about on the show this week.
Yeah.
But, MC, what's going on? Live from West Palm, WPB.
Doing well, guys. I'm embracing my old age today. You see this gray hair? It's somewhere in here.
All right.
It's like right in here somewhere.
Oh man.
You've been talking about this gray hair since I seen you 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, I got like
I'm hype.
I don't see you're hype.
You're hype?
Yeah. Oh,
okay. That's hype to be old.
Love to hear it.
I don't like
salt and pepper era.
I don't like the grays.
I get one gray right here and I get one on my head. That's cool.
I don't like it. I'm not trying to look like Morgan Freeman anytime soon.
Why not?
I don't know. I don't like it, man. I think I might dye my hair, bro. I think I might dye it black.
That would be interesting. I ain't got the time to dye it and all that shit, but if they start to pop in, you know, I embrace it.
I think you do it like once a month. I think you can dye it once a month.
I can even front. Women love the gray.
That's what I'm saying.
Women love the gray.
Yeah, you out here doing sultry drill dances.
Sultry drill.
Hey, get it right. Sexy drills taking over. Sexy drills taking the world. What is that?
That's what they did in the video.
I don't know. You know what it is? When I think about sexy drill, let's call it what it is. I'm sorry. I think about like.
Have we ever opened, did an unboxing of the sexy drill?
We haven't. Maybe we should save that for Patreon. Slizzy.
Yeah. I got the slizzy sex kit over here.
Yeah.
We're going to do an unboxing because no one's seen what's actually in this shit.
Big year for sexy drill, man.
Big year for sex.
Absolutely making the list.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sex, it has to. Sex always makes the list, but sexy drill for sure.
For sure.
Man. Oh, when I think about sexy drill and like the dance moves, I think about fucking the stripper dance. Did that ever permeate other places?
No. What is the stripper dance?
It was like an early or like a late 1990s, early 2000s, Pretty Ricky in the club or in like the party because you weren't going to clubs at that point. And just like, it was like dancing like a stripper. Like men, you've seen the videos of the guys humping the floor.
Oh, the ottoman? Oh, the couch? Peer pressure.
Bro,
peer pressure.
I guess, I don't know if it's an LA thing or not. They used to call it the stripper dance.
Yeah, but, and if people don't remember this or even have known about it, this video is still on YouTube, by the way.
Oh, I mean, there's videos all over YouTube, all different type of people.
But the most iconic one is like the boy group Peer Pressure, where all they did, it was a bunch of teenagers who were just in one room. It was like five of them, and they would like walk into the camera and be like, "My name Pressure, and I'm about to show you what I do." And then he would like,
"Yeah, that was a thing in Los Angeles." Like, I don't know if that was just an LA thing. I don't know where those guys were from.
In Atlanta, I think.
Oh, that was a thing, like the stripper dance. Like the niggas would be in parties doing that shit, like listening to Pretty Ricky,
bro.
And it was just a point where, like, I feel like those guys turned into like the clown dancers, who turned into like crumpers and so forth. But yeah, man, that's what it reminds me of when I think about it.
That is insanely crazy because, like, when you think about it, people were joked about that once it kind of hit like mainstream, if you will, and now it's like kind of coming back in a different way.
It's just
crazy.
Yeah, it's just horny kids. It's funny when I think about it, because the hood niggas was doing that shit.
Yeah,
gangsters was doing the stripper dance. Like it wasn't like no feminine type shit. It was like gangsters, hood niggas, and like athletes. Yeah. Pulling their shirts over their heads.
Especially athletes, bro. Like, athletes will only wear like maybe two outfits. One of them was a jersey and jeans and Jordans, and the other one was just their like workout gear, like the workout shorts.
Or it's a combination of that, like the basketball shorts with the jeans over it.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, that's what the look really was. Basketball shorts with the jeans over it, white tee flipped over your head with your abs showing.
T-shirt on your head, by the way.
The stripper dance.
T-shirt wrapped on your head. That was it. That was a big one where I was at in high school. That's some country shit probably, though.
Yeah, I mean, it happened a few times here, but yeah, I don't know why we got into that. That's, yeah.
It's because we start off with the best evolution. Song of the week. Yeah, we start with the best song of the week. Shout out Cash Cobain.
Yeah. Shout out Charlie too. I really respect Drake for taking that flow, and we'll get to Drake later. On the B sides actually, so make sure you subscribe to the Patreon.
Yeah, because I mean the discourse. What more could we say about it? But what we're gonna say about it?
Later. Yeah. So you might want to hear what I gotta say about it. So subscribe.
I mean, I guess we got some like kind of somber news to start on. We didn't really have much to say as it happened. As you guys already know. BlkPrint Radio has been kind of shelved.
Man.
It's been shut down, so to speak. RIP. RIP to
shut down. That shit shut. Yeah, it ain't sort of. It's shut down. It's gone. 10/31. Shit will cease to exist. Man.
So, I mean, of course, in 1 week, we will be doing our final show for the BlkPrint on October 25th. It's going to be kind of a farewell show. I still want to do the theme of, like, you know, we're still going to do, like, the scary song, spooky song. We're still going to do that, but we're going to have some of our past guests come in. We're going to have the listeners. If you're a listener, you know, tune in to AMP that night, 6 o'clock Pacific, 9 o'clock Eastern. We're going to be doing a lot of really cool stuff. But, I mean, my fucking heart goes out to, and, you know, my thought. I need to text Galen back. He texted
me
the
other
day.
Yeah, yeah. I was running around when he sent that. But thoughts and prayers, man. I think such a great idea. Amazing idea. Mm-hmm. Shout out to Matt for that idea. The technology was great. It just, you know, we're in an era where live audio is still an acquired taste.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I just feel like they didn't give it enough time. But I love the platform. I love the community we grew there. I love just the people who tapped in weekly and were engaging and just, like, really, you know, pushed me to do it and pushed me to feel good about being on the platform. So
that's what sucked, because I feel like we were starting to get into, like, a really good groove.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, we had did the Jeezy tier list. Then we did hip-hop trivia. Then we had, like, we just had so many people, like, coming every week to be like, yo, I hope I get called up this week. I hope I get to talk on the show this week. And, you know, it feels like, in a way, we got the rug kind of pulled from under us.
Absolutely.
In some ways. And I think the one thing that I learned the most about our fan base is that, like, they're ready to interact. They love to interact with us. And I think that we were finally getting to that moment on AMP. And that really sucks, man. And you know, to all the creators, especially like Tim and Q, they had their own things kind of bubbling there. They were really rolling on there. And, you know, just to have that whole thing kind of end so abruptly just really sucks.
Yeah, but I think, you know, shout out to Tim and Q. Shout out to, you know, Zach Sang and everyone else that was on the platform. I think it definitely empowered us to kind of continue on in different ways. So I hope to see all these shows in different forms and different life in other places.
Yeah.
And
because a lot of these people didn't have shows before.
Yeah, no, like Tim and Q didn't have a show before AMP. And now, you know, they've got such a great friendship, and I love to see it, or love to listen to it on air. And I just want to see that continue to flourish and see it in another form.
Yeah, we met with them, what was it, late last year.
Yeah.
They were super excited, and again, like, they really went all in on it. And it's going to be cool to see what they do next. But I know people have been asking us what's next. And I think that what's next is really trying to interact with you guys more. Yeah. You know, people watching here, people listening, you know, through Spotify or whatever you guys are listening to the podcast on. I think it's just expanding our fan base to do that. Like, we want to do more live stuff.
Yeah, no, I think live, you know, I love Twitch, and I love what, you know, the streamers are building over there. We'll love a streamer check. So. So what's up, man? Kai, Aiden, y'all want to come and collab? Let's do it, man.
Kai's going through some shit right now.
Is he?
Yeah, he's beefing with his homeboys. They falling out. The guy
saw
Bruce.
A storyline, man. Saw a storyline. Like, they need to bring me in. Bring me in a storyline, man. I'm ready for it.
It do feel like a storyline, because, like, the way that it happened is, like, and I'm learning about this through TikTok. That's the only way you learn about young nigga news.
Oh, shit.
So it's like, you go on TikTok, and it's like my whole algorithm. And I guess it's because I was watching so much of the Offset Kai stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And that's why it was coming up on my algorithm. But apparently his boy Bruce, who was part of his crew, had some texts come out where he was dissing him.
Oh, shit.
And then Kai went on, and he was just like, I want you to win, just not with me. And everyone was like, yo, that shit hit different. I was like, bro, didn't somebody say that before?
Hey, that's a FYB J-Man. It's funny, man. The internet's a funny place. There's a lot of funny characters popping up on the internet. It's always been like this, but yeah. I think, you know, between the streamers and the YouTube stars and the TikTok kids, it's a lot of personalities in the atmosphere yeah. right now.
More money, more problems, Kai. Yeah. I feel you. But in trying to figure out what we're doing next, and you know, we've had meetings about it. We've been talking to people about it and stuff like that. It's like we're starting to come to a point where, like, I think it might be a little bit like out of the ordinary for us, especially where it's like we got to kind of figure out what we're gonna do next. And I think with content creation, and that goes with Kai and all of them, you say in the storyline, which is funny because it could be, yeah. but it's like there's a struggle of trying to stay new and relevant and create more content with the changing media landscape. It's like you go from Twitch to Kick to Rumble, you go from Amp to YouTube to Twitch, man, or whatever.
I'm
like,
open. Kick, Rumble, I'm down. Holla at me. Put me in the storyline. Write me in.
Kick I believe Kick is owned by Stake. Okay. Which is that the gambling?
You know,
thing.
I do a little bit of gambling. I could come on here and give y'all some picks for the week, man. Rams money line, Bills money line. I honestly, it's funny. Like we had a big sports episode a couple weeks ago, yeah. me and Mark, when you were out, and I would really like to look into that. I think, you know, the sports angle is cool. I watch a ton of sports. I'm really into like gambling now on sports. I think
really,
yeah, I've really gotten into it lately. Lost a ton of money, but it's a
that's what happens when you got too much money. I ain't even have it. All right. I didn't have it loaded.
Let's run it.
I didn't have our sounds loaded.
Load it up, man.
It's early, bro. I didn't have our sounds loaded. There we go.
Too much money. I love to hear it. I love that.
That's how you got too much. But I mean, like, it is like something where it's like we even doing the show, it's like we got to come up with things to talk about, right? It's yeah. like, and I'm not complaining anyway. Like I love to talk about anything with you guys, but. Like that could be a struggle for people, and I think that when something monumental like Amp shutting down happens, like people were thinking that this was going to be going on forever.
You yeah, know what I mean? Nah, like, I missed that check.
Yeah, but it's like okay, now what's next? And it's like there could be like a sense of like all right, confusion or really just kind of being lost. Like when you put and again, this isn't really our reality because like we have our own kind of things that we're doing, but like
yeah, yeah.
if your reality is that like your whole life is predicated on creating content every single week or every other week or something like that, like something like this, and I'm noticing it now, so it can make you feel like, yo, like what the fuck, like what am I gonna do next? Oh, it can leave you feeling kind of on your own island out here.
No, definitely. And that's why, you know, I encourage all of the AMP creators to keep going.
Yeah.
Figure out where your space is, YouTube, Patreon, TikTok, IG, you know, just stay consistent. That's always the name of the game, the key yeah. to the game. And, you know, I kind of want to keep hearing from you guys. I don't want to mm-hmm. just see it go by the wayside. I will say I did love the fact that we could play music. And
yes.
That aspect is gone. Hopefully someone sees this amazing idea and picks it up. Hopefully someone revives AMP. Yeah. You know, it's never forever, I always say.
I hope not. Yeah. I hope it's not forever. Like, and this is coming from someone who's been fired from many jobs, by the way. But like, I was kind of happy on my own, like the way that I kind of handled the news. Cause I usually yeah. something like that, I would probably be freaking the fuck out.
Yeah. Nah, it's funny. I took it in stride. I take things like this in stride. I think that's just my demeanor for a lot of these big changes and moments in life. You mm-hmm. know, like I said, it's never forever. And for me, selfishly, I just wanted my Wednesdays back. I need a little more free time just to think.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think I've already thought of something to fill that time. Like, I've been back reading a lot.
Yeah.
I have a few books that I need to get through. Shout out to Rich Paul. I'm wearing a sweatsuit right now. I just got his book last week. So yeah,
I heard it was good. I heard that book's really good.
I haven't started it yet, but I'm excited to dig into it. I've been reading a Jeezy book, which is really good.
Yeah.
Also, I think we talked about this on the show when people were like Jeezy in the Subway sandwiches.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
He wasn't lying. There was actually a $2 Subway sandwich. Shout out to Young Jeezy.
Jeezy's gotten us a lot of like visibility this year.
Yeah, we didn't even shout Jeezy out. He reposted one of our BlkPrint episodes. Yeah.
He reposted Throw Blacks.
Yeah, Throw Blacks. Yeah, yeah.
And I know it ain't nobody controlling his damn account. I could tell that's Jeezy.
Nah, that was Jeezy, man. Hey, salute, man. Snowman, one of my favorite rappers. Honored to be in your presence, get a photo. Took a request from me for his concert. always gonna be an important moment in my life.
Next time, pass him the file for Throw Black so he can hear Mark's rankings.
Oh man, he might take his post back.
Yeah.
Why? He loves it. He loves inspiration like I do. I know he does.
He doesn't.
But yeah, I've already decided to fill in that time. I'm gonna be reading more. But I do miss AMP. I miss the community. And you know, shout out to everybody over there: Galen, Kelton, Matt, Brian, Christine. Great team, man. Looking forward to what all you guys do next.
Yeah, but what's next for BlkPrint? I mean, we got Q4. Like, it's we're still rolling.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We're still rolling on this podcast. We're still rolling on Patreon. Obviously, Throw Blacks is coming. We're going to talk a little bit more about our Throw Black schedule for the upcoming months on B-Sides Today. But the next one's going to be Most Unknown, 3-6 Mafia.
Yeah, excited for that one, man. Spooky. Halloween, yeah. Perfect for the timing.
This album isn't so much scary as it is like very much like braggadocious in a way that they've never been.
And yeah, I think 3-6 Mafia in general is scary.
Yeah.
Just looking at a photo of them all together. Scary ensemble.
Oh, man.
But nah, I'm excited for this one. I feel like we're always timely with ours.
Yes.
I just looked up the 25th anniversary of Dookie, Green Day's first album is this year.
Yeah.
And that was just amazing to see. I saw a billboard for it. I was like, oh shit, Throw Blacks. But I'm looking forward to 3-6 Mafia one, man. I think, you know, we're expanding and getting more into just other
genres.
Not even other genres, but just, you know, people who aren't as appreciated as groups and artists.
Absolutely.
I think that's something that hip hop is missing now, is just looking back at our real forefathers.
I feel like, and for anyone that like looks at Throw Blacks, and I've heard this comment before, and they'll be like, I don't know anything about them. I don't know anything about it. I've never heard the album. Listen to Throw Blacks because, like, we all know about a lot of this. So it's like, if you didn't know anything about Jeezy, or you didn't know anything about Carter Four, even or Deep in the Rap, like, we have we lived it. So, like, we know what's going on. There's a lot of knowledge that comes out of these episodes. Like, if you've been skipping it on our Patreon and you haven't been listening to it, I would advise you to check out Throw Blacks. Like, it is probably some of my favorite content that we make every single month.
Yeah.
Like, it's always fun. It's always great to, like, again, put in Josh through the ringer for Carter Four is one of my favorite moments of the year. Like, I don't know if he's ever had less fun recording something.
Man, that shit was, yeah, tough album.
Did you still give it a re-listen?
Not after the fact. I listened to it up until the episode. It's funny. I was with Metro Boomin the other day, and he was like, oh, it's throwing to Carter Three. And I was like, I'm glad he didn't say Carter Four. Like, I just remember thinking that, like, damn, it's so close. Like, usually when someone wants to just put on some music, they'd be like Carter Two, maybe. But he was like Carter Three. I'm like,
but you gotta remember, he young though.
Yeah, like, no. And I'm like, oh, this was a fire album. But yeah, it's just funny to hear him say that. Like, he was like, turn off my shit, put on Carter Three.
So, something strange about the album is all the strange track lists that it had. Remember, like, when they took off the song that didn't get cleared,
Play With Fire.
Oh, yeah.
And then they put Pussy Monster.
Yeah, they changed the whole track list, and the whole album sounds off because you took that song off and put Pussy Monster there instead. It's like, wait, because that's like the serious part of the album. And then it's just got replaced. And I think La 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 got like moved too. Like, it was, Carter 3 is a weird album too. Like, it has like a lot of different track lists, but also, like, if you think about it, like, Wayne had no control over the track list or the sequencing of the album. So it's like, it was all Cortez and Mac Main doing all that shit.
That's the thing with Wayne too. I heard he really never really picked his track list.
No.
Yeah, he just always had like 500 songs and just let Cortez and Mac do this thing.
Yeah.
And it's interesting now, Cortez or Mac, I don't think work with Wayne currently.
Wow, really?
Yeah, I know Cortez doesn't. I just heard recently that Mac doesn't. Interesting.
I would have thought they would have been around like for the long run. I wonder who Cortez works with now. Then
I saw Mac Main as a fucking at the Colorado game over the weekend.
That's funny.
Yeah, he's giving niggas on the sideline Rolexes. I guess two of his homies are like coaches at Colorado.
That's funny Rolexes. As hell. Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, did you see the SNL Keenan sketch with Deion Sanders?
No, I haven't seen it.
It's really Keenan, funny.
Is he on SNL now?
Yeah, this is his last.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm thinking, what's the two guys that were on Mad TV?
What two guys that were on Mad TV?
The two guys, about Aries Spears,
Key and Peele.
Oh, Key and Peele. No, yeah. No,
weren't they on Mad TV?
No, they were on Mad TV. Yeah.
I don't know. I just saw a sketch with them and some sports shit. But Keenan.
The Keenan Thompson. It was like Weekend Update. You know, they come in and do characters. It's actually pretty funny. Like, and it's not like, he captured the actual personality of Deion Sanders well, and it wasn't like, because the one thing that I get annoyed with, and you know, sports tangent here, like, I don't like black people being like, see, you should have stayed or some shit like that.
When, oh, yeah,
when he's like, when he's losing games and shit like that. I think that's really corny. Like,
yeah, that's super corny.
Like,
I mean,
why are we wanting this man's downfall because he chose to get a better option?
Shit, like, he's going to be at Jackson State losing games too.
That's what I'm saying.
More like, games.
I don't understand it. Again, maybe it's because I'm not like super sports guy, but I look at it like, okay, I mean, of course he's going to talk his shit, and that's marketing. He said God told him to go to Jackson State. That's marketing. Like, yeah. I looked at it like, oh, yeah, he's just trying to get people to talk.
Yeah, I mean, Deion Sanders has always been the best talker and athlete. I think he just trash talk to inspirational talk. He's just always been good at it.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's what you're going to get with him. He's going to always say something that's going to make you believe.
Yeah, I was like, somebody said Deion Sanders is not him or some shit like that. And I was like, that's like, wait, I mean, it's 4 games? They only won like one or some shit last year.
Yeah, people going to pray in your downfall regardless. Love what Deion's doing. Shout out to Coach Prime. You need a new defensive coordinator, brother.
Yeah. That last loss I heard was terrible.
Yeah, they were up at like 29-0 at the halftime and then came back and lost like 49-43 or some shit.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Hey, he's still going to get his money.
Yeah.
They're definitely calling him back next season.
Like, yeah, no, I mean,
he's getting fired.
The city of Boulder's made so much money and halfway through the season that they're like, yo, they're thankful for these losses.
Exactly.
Like, we don't give a fuck.
They said, we'll care about these black people walking around our city now.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Hey, man, remember who was first. I was always a Boulder fan. I'll be out there soon.
Remember who was first?
Yeah, bro, I love Boulder, Colorado. I went there in like 2012. Man, yeah. And I loved it. Fell in love with the city.
It's cold out there, man.
Yeah, I've always told myself that I want to open up a streetwear store there, like by campus. I will eventually. That's one of my goals.
That's an interesting place to do it, because it's like if you corner that one market, you're like the first person there. You're like the only person there. Yeah. All of them, you get so much fun.
No, I mean, it's kids in every year, disposable income.
Yeah.
You know, a good ratio of like kids with money.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah.
And then you're not that far from Denver, which is about 30 to 45 minutes. So you're going to get those athletes and those city kids coming in. I definitely thought this out. I want to open up a store there.
Hey, you got it.
Yeah.
B and D to that one.
Definitely on AMP, live Tuesdays and Thursdays. It's so nice to meet you.
Michelle Beadle, The Kid Merrill.
Zach Sang Show, my show.
With the number one show, you know what I'm saying, pertaining to F1 out there.
And I have a show on AMP called Josh and Around.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Sterling. Come tune in to my show, The Upside.
You just say your name. I got this.
I'm Justin J5 Davis.
Josh Pease.
Well, I wish I could give you the tea, but mine's just a little bit tart, and that's why it's called Leah's Lemonade. Make sure you tune into my show on AMP.
On AMP.
We got to talk about this Jada Pinkett stuff.
Man,
while it's still kind of timely. Do we? Yeah, I mean, we kind of have to.
Yeah, she's crazy.
We talked about the slap. We talked about all types of things with Chris Rock and Will Smith, and Jada Pinkett has a book coming out.
Yep, I saw that.
And she's doing a press tour, obviously. Was Red Table Talk canceled, or is it?
Facebook canceled it. Yeah,
because they were like, yeah, we can't do this shit no more.
Yep.
So now she's bringing the Red Table Talk everywhere.
Interesting that it was canceled, because I feel like it did good numbers.
I think it did too. I just think that the cost was probably really, really high to retain the staff and all that other stuff. Like, it might have been.
My thing with that show is, I mean, it wasn't super high production level, but I hate when like you have these stars and it's like you cost a lot to do this show.
Yeah,
that's a great idea. I think, you know, with just that, and I think there's a space for black folks to get in their feelings and be on camera and talk about those things. And I think if she was really about the idea, she would have kept it going herself and just bankrolled it herself.
You feel like
put it on YouTube.
You feel like it was like about the check at that point?
Yeah, I mean,
like,
absolutely. I mean, when you seen some of the later guests and like the Will episode and the crying and shit like that, it's absolutely about the check. But I think about that show, and I think about, you know, when Keke Palmer went through whatever she did with Usher. Like, that should have been a Red Table Talk.
Yeah, that would have
like,
been
there's
funny.
Been so many moments that should have been Red Table Talks that haven't been, and it's just because the show is very self-serving and about the check for her.
Yeah.
But I love the concept behind it. Like, you know, before she started doing all the... I mean, before their life became this spectacle after the slap, I really looked at Jada and her family as something that was really interesting and something that black folks needed. It wasn't the normal family dynamic. But it worked. You know, you had Willow, you had her mom, you had Jaden. Like, they're not the normal Cosby family when you look at black folks. But it's, you know, black folks aren't a monolith.
Yeah.
We have these type of families and these dynamics, and they should be, you know, put on that pedestal. But I feel like since the slap, that shit's just unraveled, and you've been like, something we should look to.
Before the slap, entanglements.
That's what I'm saying. The entanglements. There's a lot of things that happen. You're like, I don't know if y'all should be looked up to.
And it's interesting you say that, because now she's come out, and there's been so many things that she said, all right?
Yeah.
But I think like the one of the biggest statements that she made was that that she and Will had been separated since 2016. And I think it was interesting that you say that this was kind of like the picture of black love. I think that's what everyone keeps saying. Like, people keep saying, you made us think that, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. To which I say, like, okay, we probably shouldn't be kind of like, you know, putting all of our chips in this basket, because everybody has problems. Every marriage has issues. Yeah. Every relationship has issues.
Which like isn't, even to that point, it's like, we should see those things and see that play out. But she just kept twisting the knife. I'm like, damn, bitch.
Like marriage is hard, okay? Being married and being famous, I couldn't imagine it, all right? Like, that's probably even harder, because everything you do is put under scrutiny. My issue with them is that they're putting themselves under the scrutiny. Like, they're actually putting themselves in the spotlight. And for her to say, like, let's just think about it. She said that they haven't been together since 2016. That was, like, literally, like, what, 7 years ago. And since then, we've got entanglements. We've got the slap. We've got all the little things in between, like the weird comments about Tupac. We're thinking that they're still together, that they're all together.
Yeah.
They ended the Red Table Talk with him on there saying, we ride together, we die together, bad marriage for life. They were not together.
Is that what he said? Bad marriage for life?
Yes. At the end of that.
And they like dapped up at the end.
That honestly sounds like some shit Vin Diesel was saying, like a Fast and Furious.
Well, he flipped the Bad Boys line.
Oh, yeah. That's what it was.
He flipped the Bad Boys line, and then he said bad marriage for life. But it was like, it starts to put things into perspective.
I missed the full thing. I didn't get this until now. That's tough. Damn, Will. I mean, I've heard Will be out here doing his thing. I just seen a picture of him and like some chick in like Egypt, like kissing the statues.
No, wait, like, what? Kissing the statue or each other?
No, like, you know, they did the picture where they like posing like with the Sphinx.
Okay.
They're like both kissing both ends of it.
Yeah.
I'm like, Will Smith got a little Goomar, you know? He travels the world with. I ain't mad at it.
This is my thing though. What does she gain from all of this other than the general annoyance of everyone? Because I don't think this is just being real. I think it's just like at some point it's just like, we don't need to hear about none of it.
That's
no
just attention, man. You know, one thing that we have to understand, that celebrities are, you know, they love attention.
Yes.
And especially celebrities that aren't really celebrities. Like, you look at Jada Pinkett, like, you ain't really popping. Like, what's the last movie you really been in? Like,
what was it? Was it Girls Trip?
Yeah, it might, but it's like, even that, it's like, you ain't on Will level. So it's like, you know, I think celebrities are starved for attention.
I don't even think Will is on Will's level. Let's be real.
I mean, no. When he did the slap, he won an Oscar right after.
He did the Slave movie right after that. Like the Slave movie.
I didn't like the Slave movie, but I watched it. So I'm like, damn. I'm pretty sure he made his money. And, you know, Will's Will. I think his shit slowed down a little bit because of the slap.
Yeah.
But Will still will. Jada's just out here just wilding, man.
We got to go further, though. We got to go to the slap, all right?
Got
to go to the slap. She says that she sees the slap, and then she hears Will say, "Don't talk shit about my wife." He said, "What did he say? Keep my wife's name out your mouth."
Yeah.
Then she says, "Damn, I'm not your wife."
She crazy for that one. Also, the slap is even more justified. I didn't know that Chris Rock tried to holler at Jada.
But that's the thing. Here's the thing, though, bro. They were already separated.
I know, but still, and Will probably knew. Too. She probably told him, like, you know, Chris tried to get at me at one point. Like, he just had that in the back of his mind. So then when we cracking jokes, she's like, you cracking jokes on my wife, and you tried to holler, I'm definitely about to slap you. Like, I got all the ammo I need. Like, nah.
No,
he should have gotten a mic. Like, I would have gotten a mic and said some shit. Like, did you just try to holler at her? Like, I would have,
cut
a promo on his ass.
But that's the thing. It's like, her reaction to the slap is just like, she's basically carrying it like she was just like, I don't know why he did that. Like, like crazy.
Side note, it's so interesting about the slap. Like, I feel like black folks just refer to it as like the slap. And it's like, even the slap, it was a slap, but it wasn't like a hard slap. Like, he slapped his ass, but he wasn't bleeding. It wasn't like,
wow.
He shocked his ass. Yeah. Wow. He like shocked him more than he like hurt him. But like, if you talk to other people about the slap, they call that shit assault. Like, hey, he battered, he assaulting battery. Like, I was watching like a video, and they're like, yeah, after he assaulted Chris Rock at the Oscars, I'm like, he assaulted him?
Because to us, assault is like,
assault is like a couple punches.
Like that?
Yeah, a couple punches, a tussle.
A slap is like you got bitch slapped.
Yeah,
like,
I mean, he literally got bitch slapped. Like, it wasn't like, that's what I'm saying. Like, it was literally like a bitch slap. Like, it wasn't like he assaulted him.
Oh my God.
I was watching something last night and it was like, yeah, man, after Will assaulted Chris Rock at the Oscars, it was all downhill. And I was like, assaulted him?
That's how crazy celebrities are. And it's like, and you talked about attention grabbing. Like, you see it during the strike now. You see it during like world events that happen. Like, celebrities have to put themselves out there in some way, shape, or form so that you take the attention off of whatever it is and put it on them. And I think like the slap was like one of their moments. Like, Judd Apatow, the director, Knocked Up, think about the children or some shit like that. He could have killed them up there.
What kids are watching the Oscars?
Amy Schumer, fucking, oh my God, I can't believe this happened. Zoe Kravitz, apparently we could slap people now or some shit. It's just like,
yeah. He ain't the first thing to get slapped. He ain't the last.
Like that, like as if the Oscars are some like prestigious, like, you know what I mean. I think a lot of people look at like the, and again, this is slap talk again, but it's like they look at like him getting like banned from it, like whatever, like show up to the Source Awards, there's some shit like that. Like, yeah, come to our awards, Will. You can still come to the BET Hip Hop Awards.
Is he still banned?
He's still banned. Yeah,
he'll be back.
He'll be back probably when he's about to retire or some shit. They'll let him back in on some like weird.
He's been for like a decade, right?
Is it for a decade?
I don't think they put a time on it.
Oh, yeah, he'll probably be back before the decade is over. All he needs is one hot one. Because if he gets nominated again, they gotta invite the nigga. Like,
if he does, I mean, they probably won't nominate him because he's. But he just needs to. We ain't ready for the redemption story yet.
Yeah,
let's let the strikes pass. Well, things happen.
We gotta let Jada burn out because now she keeps talking about Tupac.
Yeah, didn't she say he had what's the shit she got?
Alopecia.
Tupac had alopecia is crazy. Is that why he had the bald head?
She said, a lot of people don't know this, but he had alopecia and I loved his bald head or some shit. I was like, bro, man. I cannot believe when it's like cringy, bro.
Her
like,
time is crazy. She did this after like a Feeny pass. So it's like a Feeny can't come back and be like, my son didn't have that shit. Like, it's a lot of little, like, she's funny with her timing.
She said that he wanted to be engaged to marry her. Like, she visited.
And then she said they didn't have chemistry, though. I'm like, you're weird. Like, where are the outlaws at? I need the outlaws to refute some of these facts that she's throwing out there.
But it's like, is she going through something? Like, is there something we're not seeing on the surface? Like,
yeah, she's going through something. She's going through attention. She know what gets her attention. On his birthday last year, she posted the video of them rapping.
Tupac.
They're rapping Will Smith.
Yeah, Tupac and her were rapping Will Smith. And as a husband or
that
a
was like a jab. That was a jab for sure.
Super jab.
What would you do in that situation, Josh, if you saw that? You go on Instagram, you're like, damn, I wonder who told me.
I mean, was that his first time seeing that?
What if it
was that on Will's birthday or Tupac's birthday?
It was on Will's birthday, wasn't it?
No, I think that was on Tupac's birthday because Tupac
passed. So like it was on Tupac's birthday. You know Will sees everything. Will is very online.
I think Will already knew what it was. Like he probably like Tupac birthday coming up. Let me stay offline for like 48 hours. I think that's his thing. Like, all right, I know what it is already.
The way the algorithm worked, that shit's still gonna pop up on Thursday.
Man, Jada's crazy, man. I'm like, how you been holding on to this footage that long?
But that
what other footage you got?
And where was it? How did you convert it to MP4?
Oh, you know she digitized that shit a long time ago.
Yo,
in that Walgreens, what?
You know when Jada dies, it's gonna be a whole new vault of Tupac shit unleashed.
Bro,
songs and poems. And
bro, I feel like with women, like there's always one that got away. That shit they'll never let go of.
Actually, we need to go back to that video and check and see if it's AI. Jada probably got enough money to make an AI Tupac video.
Of the one that got away, okay? And I feel like she feels like Tupac is the one that got away.
Maybe she do feel like that. That's crazy.
Everybody's got that one.
The one that got away is Tupac, but you married to Will Smith. That's a crazy, like, low-key.
Yeah, like.
And then your affair was August Alsina. It's crazy.
He's not blind. That was Houston. Blind to one eye. He stabbed himself. Remember him?
Oh, yeah, I do remember.
I like that.
Damn, that song is big in L.A.
Nate Dogg was on it. No, he was from...
He might have been from Houston.
He might have been from Houston.
Yeah. Houston.
That song turns 20 next year.
Why did he stab himself in the eye again?
How did you know
some
that?
Jesus shit.
Yeah, 2004. A lot of crazy shit turns 20 next year.
Yeah, he was on like drugs or something, I remember.
Yeah, because I remember he had a video where he was just outside talking about why he did it. He said the industry made him do it.
Yeah, the industry made him do it.
He might have been August Alsina if he hadn't done that.
Shit.
He could have been August Alsina. Who knows? But I mean, again, Jada, more power to you. I think honestly a lot of people are just tired of hearing about it. I think after this, I don't want to hear about it. I think the comment they're saying now is take us out the group chat.
Yeah. I mean, I'm like, damn, save some for the book.
Well, she hates the guy. Like, I know my wife had read Will Smith's book, and she was not a fan of Will Smith's book, but he talks about how Jada said that a lot of stuff that he does is based on ego. So I think that I think when we're thinking of Will as kind of like the good guy here, like I think that it's mutual on both sides that they both can't stand each other. I think that's
I can see that.
Like he said that he had done like I think one of the anecdotes that he had brought up that kind of like started the schism between these two was that on her birthday, I think he had gotten he threw this huge party in some like foreign country, brought in all of her friends, flew in like celebrities and all this stuff, and she was just like, "You didn't do this for me. You did this for you because I don't even like this type of shit." But you did this for you. And he was like, you did this based off your ego. And I was like, damn, like at the time when I heard that, I was like, damn, they must hate each other. And now I'm like, yeah. Yo, they really fucking hate each other.
I mean, yeah, that's crazy. I mean, you just don't want the gift from that nigga. Tupac threw the party from the grave. You'd be like, oh shit, surprise. Like
she got the hair done.
Yeah. Sexy drilling.
Tupac doing sexy drills, killing me. We already did enough Tupac combo on this show.
Man.
Shorty would have fucked with the club.
Tupac would have absolutely been making sexy drill music.
Absolutely.
That nigga was horny as hell.
Fucking Hennessy, my enemies.
I never forget that nigga. He had a song with Left Eye Lopez.
Yeah. Listen.
That song was horny as hell.
The old rappers would be doing just about fucking anything right now if they were still alive.
I wouldn't say anything, but
he
would be making a lot of sexy drill.
B.I.G. would be on Twitch playing Madden.
Nah.
Play Madden?
Why Madden? Notorious B.I.G. would be on Twitch playing Madden.
Chill out. Big would probably be what Jay-Z is right now.
Yeah, yeah. He probably would be
in offices. He probably fuck around on a team right now.
Also
on
playing the Brooklyn Nets. Also playing Twitch. I'm telling
sitting
you.
Sitting in two chairs. Well,
Tupac actually does seem more like the Twitch guy to me.
No, I don't see that from them just because like how revolutionary they were. Like Tupac would probably be a politician right now.
Wow.
Biggie would be a businessman owning half of Manhattan.
Record label for sure. Yeah. He would be like Lior. Because the thing is, think about like just how unstoppable these two would be if they were still alive, yo.
Yeah. No, that like that should
be different.
That's one thing I always say about Tupac and Biggie. Like they died so young, but look at their impact and look at just how powerful they were at those ages. Mm-hmm. Like you have no rappers currently who were as powerful as them when they passed.
Yeah.
It's actually kind of crazy. What? Like it shows how rap is like.
I say you got two rappers that have the power. Like generationally, it's Kendrick and Drake that like have that.
To a certain degree, but also you got to think, they died at 25 years old.
True.
Kendrick and Drake, 36, 30, like, and they still not really, like, there as far as, like, what their voice is and can be. I mean, maybe
dead.
Kendrick's is a little closer to, no, I mean, like, just even just how, like, look at Tupac. He was absolutely a revolutionary.
Yeah.
And died at 25. Mm-hmm. I can't say that for neither of them.
I think in terms of, it depends on how we measure that metric. Like if you measure it through Drake's metric, everybody sounds or everyone does things that he does. You know
yeah, but like, I'm like, that's like on the surface shit. I'm talking about like Tupac absolutely would have been like, let's go march when they killed the cops. Like Drake or Kendrick not
they didn't
doing
do,
that.
Yeah,
yeah they'll never do that.
Yeah.
And it's like, one thing, well, we can talk about Drake later, but it's a line in Drake's album where he's like, he talks about beefing with people older than him or something.
Yeah, all of my enemies are older guys or something like that.
And it's I'm just like, who is he talking about?
It's on,
is it, I mean, I guess he's talking about like Pharrell and Kanye.
And Pusha. And
yeah, like I guess. That. Okay, that makes sense. I was always trying to figure out that line. I'm like,
it's on What Would Pluto Do?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, it's,
I like
was
that song.
Yeah, it's a good song. Yeah, but
that's one of my favorite songs on the album.
That line is like out of place even. I'm just like, yeah. Talking about ops on
the song. Honestly, the song, it's a lot of, it switches. Like, he be talking about the girl, then he talk about the I'm like, damn, man, I can't keep on stopping. Gig it to this shit.
Sexy drill to this.
It is a good point though. If when you bring up age as far as 25 years old, if Drake were to, you know, untimely pass when he turned 25, it would have been October 2011. He would have died right before Take Care came out. And same thing with Kendrick. He would have died right around the time Good Kid, Mad City came out.
So think about that.
But if that had been where they, and this is morbid, by the way. And this is,
yeah, I'm just not, saying, just, let's not say die. Yeah, if their career had stopped at that point.
That, sure. Like, Take Care and Good Kid are considered for that, for those 2010s moments.
Those are the beginning of what their career, what their legacy would be.
Exactly, yeah.
Now look at fucking Biggie and fucking Tupac.
Yeah.
They were at the pinnacle with their legacy. Nigga, Tupac was about to hit a whole nother turn with Machiavelli and shit. Yeah. Like he was about to take off even more. Imagine, Biggie was about to have four more classic albums, it feels like. Like, that's just kind of crazy.
Imagine Dracovelli.
I mean, I think we got it with For All My Dogs.
He on the
Niggas would be so mad. Oh my God, niggas would be so mad in that cover.
There was like the rumor that Tupac said, Shook shot me.
Yeah. Bro,
what if it was Wayne shot me?
Chill out, man. That album used to scare me, bro. It was
too prophetic, bro.
Machiavelli, when it dropped, I was absolutely like a little shook. Like, damn, what the fuck? Like, I was a kid. Like, man,
the beats was so scary on that album. Mm-hmm. It was one of the most depressing albums.
They leaned into it too. Like, come with me, all that shit. I was like, well, come on, man. The rain and shit. They leaned into the spookiness of the album.
Life After Death was mad scary too.
Yes.
That too. It's like, nigga, what you name your album? Like,
it's crazy.
Man.
But then if you think about it, Take Care, if he had ended on Take Care, like, that would have been the name of his final album would have been Take Care. Huh. And then Kendrick's would have been Good Kid, Mad City.
Yeah, well, shout out to Kendrick and Drake, man.
It's October. Spooky content. We give it to you, bro. Speaking of spooky, Taylor Swift.
Man.
And I hope that her fans don't listen to the previous segment, or I'm not going to talk shit over her. But
we won't. Come on, shout out Taylor.
I'm just talking about her fans.
You know what's crazy about Taylor Swift? I've never listened to a Taylor Swift album in my life.
Never in my life.
I honestly really don't even know her songs. I mean, I probably heard a ton of them just in passing.
I know Bad Blood.
Yeah, see, I don't know her songs.
No, we got.
I know her business more than I know her songs.
Her business, you said?
Yeah,
she got good business. Well, other than her signing at crazy deal with Scooter.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't a crazy deal. It was a good deal. She made a lot of money off that deal.
made money again by putting him out again, which is crazy.
It's funny. I don't know. Did we ever talk about this in that show?
We did a little bit.
It's a good deal. She made a ton of money. She's the reason why she's Taylor Swift. Like, when you sign with a label, they own your masters. That's a part of it. We're going to pump this money into you, and we're going to own part of the masters, and that's how we make our money. People look at the labels like, oh, the bad guy, because you own their music. It's like, yeah, I invested in this. I want to own some of this investment.
Yeah.
It's like if you buy a house and you live in the house and you put all this money into the house and then you don't own the house, it's like, that's a raw deal.
I think people thought of it as predatory because of her age at the time, which...
Her age. She made a ton of money. It's predatory when you don't make no money.
yeah.
But
she just put out a movie, the Eras Tour movie. Yeah. I don't know if you've seen the videos of this shit.
I have seen some video. I've seen a video of like an actor, like a white actor guy. He was like breakdancing in the front
Taylor
of the
movie. Taylor Lautner, her ex-boyfriend.
Oh, that's her ex-boyfriend?
Yeah, I believe.
He was like breakdancing in the movie theater.
He was wilding. I was like, bro, you wanted that? You want that old thing back. That's why he was doing
it. He like, I'm athletic too.
Dude from Twilight?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's what he's from.
Yeah.
Damn.
He pulled up, said.
How'd they date?
Then he started, I was like, bro.
Dabbing? How'd they date if they was both named Taylor?
Bro, that was the whole thing back then.
I found out. Side note, this is very much a side note. Taylor Swift has a cousin named Taylor Swift. Yeah, I don't know. I ran into somebody the other day and they were telling me that.
That's like Hits Blunt once. And it's just
like she literally has a cousin named Taylor Swift.
So in these videos, you got the girl singing the songs. I feel bad for the niggas watching Oppenheimer next to the theater.
Theater's better be soundproof.
shit going down and they hear fucking I don't know what the fucking name of her songs are. I've listened to an Adele album before I listened to a Taylor Swift album, which is great.
Is that Royal? Is Royals one of her songs?
That's Lord.
Oh,
that's Lord. Yeah.
Jesus Christ. You really haven't listened.
I mean, I know them when I hear them in like Macy's and shit. And I don't really know them. I just have heard them in settings like that, Target. But I don't really know her music.
It's not for us anyway. But the one video I saw was when the girls were dancing.
Yeah, even that. Row. I saw that. I'm like, is that how they dance at her shows?
Is that what they do? Is that the type of it? Not to be disrespectful, it seemed kind of cult like.
That's their mosh pit.
Open up that pit.
Open up that pit and swing.
Yep. Ring around a Rosie.
It definitely reminded me of Midsommar.
Midsommar.
Yeah, was that? Yeah,
Midsommar.
Yeah,
yeah. It's I don't really know what to call it. Looks kind of weird, but it made $90 million this weekend.
Yeah, no, and to that point, shout out to her fan base, man. I'm trying to have a fan base that brings in $90 million first week.
They pulled up. Beyonce pulled up to the Grove.
Yeah.
She never heard that one.
Yeah.
To see the movie with her. She did TikToks with her. I'm like, that's a good play for Beyonce. Coming
yeah,
up to
I mean,
her.
Beyonce
knows
her
own movie. She got her own movie coming to AMC in December, too.
Yeah, that's low-key Beyonce kissing the ring.
Wow.
I ain't going front, man. Wow. Like, a lot of people have the Beyonce, Taylor, wow. Like, I ain't going front. The Taylor got her.
Yeah.
Taylor got her. Like, I wish it wasn't like that. I want wow. Beyonce to have it, but it's like, Taylor got her.
I didn't think of it that way. I thought of it like, whatever. But, like, I didn't think of it like this.
If Beyonce do a premiere, I don't know if Taylor Swift going to show up.
Wow.
Keep it on honey.
Taylor showed up for Ice Spice at SNL.
Oh, shit, she did?
Yeah.
That's fire.
Introduced her.
But that's Taylor, like, I need a street cred.
Yeah.
Taylor been, she been everywhere lately.
Yeah.
She everywhere, like, she got a motherfucking, another album about to drop.
She like, she a new artist.
Yeah,
like,
she was at a bunch of the Chiefs games.
Yeah.
She had fucking SNL.
She's working.
I wonder what kind of jet she got.
Oh, come on, man. She got a spaceship. She got time travel. That's
yeah,
how much money she got.
She going crazy.
She's out here. I gotta salute her for the $90 million tied for the best October opening with Joker, which came out a couple years ago. But what I wanted to talk to you guys about is with concert movies, it seems to be a thing that's going to happen.
Yeah.
Like, I think that a lot of labels are going to look at concert movies. I wouldn't be surprised if Travis Scott gets one. Wouldn't be surprised if maybe Drake gets one down the line for this tour he was on just now. What concert movie would we watch in a theater that would have us fucking daisy chain and fucking ring around the rosy in the fucking theater? Sexy drilling.
I think it got to be. I agree. I think this is the next wave. I think concert tickets are so expensive.
Mm-hmm.
This is another way to get that
experience.
Content, that experience out there. And it's just a way to get shit to places people don't go. Like, we always talk about how Virginia Beach doesn't get shows.
Yep.
They're going to go see it at the movie theater.
Yep.
I don't know. Drake would be a great one. I saw that live, and I'm like, oh, this could look good. Travis Scott, I can't wait to see Travis Scott's show.
Yeah.
That stage looks ridiculous.
It's like the stage is like the size of a football
field. That stage looks like fucking a ride at fucking Universal Studios.
Yeah.
I like kind of want to walk the stage. Like, I'm trying to, like, I need to see if I can just, in the morning when they're setting up, just go through there and just.
I've tried to stay partially unspoiled on the Travis Scott thing because it looks just so massive. Like, yeah. I was like, he came a long way from the Big Bird. To like what it is,
man,
now.
Travis has always had a crazy stage set. I remember when he had the roller coaster.
Yeah, for Astro.
I always wanted to ride that fucking roller coaster.
You could actually get on it?
He used to bring fans on.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah, they used to bring fans on when he did a song. That shit was dope.
That's scary as hell.
Yeah, Drake, Travis, Tyler would be a good
one. Tyler would be a good, especially this last one.
Yeah.
He did.
Yeah. I would like to see that footage intermixed with like backstage and like getting ready for the show. Like, I want to hear that story. Like, I don't know if Taylor's is like that, if it's just straight show.
I think it's straight show, but it has like different cut, like different, like obviously, like, you know, they're going to have different performances.
Different cities.
Yeah, different cities and stuff like that. But I think that would be, it remind me of backstage.
Yeah, I want the lead up. I want to hear about I want to see the rehearsal. I want to see you. You know, artists are athletes in their own right. I want to see you doing the dance moves and getting it wrong and twisting your ankle and like, I'm about to fight through it. Like, I want the story. Like,
you got
to
see the prayer, you know, every time before a show, the prayer, like, thank you guys so much.
Actually, I would love to see Beyonce. I didn't see the Beyonce show in live. I would love to see, like,
it's coming in summer.
Her process. Oh, yeah. But hopefully it has her process throughout it and then her on stage because she's like, she's probably the best performer of our generation.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and I think, you know, that is like some Last Dance type shit.
If we were to go back in time, what would be some concerts that you guys would watch in theaters and like really go crazy over? Like, to me, I would love to see Rock the Mic tour in theaters. That would be crazy.
Yeah, mine would be it'd be like the real classics, like Prince, Michael Jackson. Who else?
Under the Influence tour too would be dope to see.
Yeah, yeah.
Because again, you got like Eminem at the height of his powers. Dre, Snoop, that was an exhibit.
Wait, was that Under Influence or was that Crime?
No, I want Up in Smoke and I want Anger Management.
Yeah, Up in Smoke. Was it Up in Smoke?
Yeah, that's what you're thinking of. Up in Smoke tour. I literally have that DVD still. Great tour. I used to watch that shit all the time.
There's a lot, and especially with the concerts. You mentioned the tickets being so high. The experiences are so premium now in terms of like the actual scope of what they do. I liked what Weeknd did. And actually, now thinking about it, Weeknd kind of started it, but it wasn't in the theater. He did it with the After Hours thing on HBO Max, which I thought was fantastic. It'll end up, that will probably end up being in one of my favorite things I watched this year.
Okay.
Because it was actually very well put together. And it didn't really, unless I didn't notice, it didn't cut to too many different cities very often, but it was like straight through.
Okay.
And that was like really, really dope. And again, like if you never heard the guy live, like I was like in shock. It sounded like the album.
Oh no, Weeknd really liked that. His voice is really, you know, auto-tune, just go out there and sing. I've always appreciated that about him.
But hearing like some of our favorite songs on like them fucking Dolby speakers and shit like that would be fucking dope. Yep. Like I couldn't imagine. I know them Taylor Swift fans be fucking getting their ears blown out from the way them shits are sounding.
Yeah.
We need to hear like some real, like if they did do It's All a Blur or Kendrick's fucking, and again, he did it on Amazon.
The Kendrick
like,
tour, yeah.
Yeah, like he did that on streaming. Like now it seems like the best way to do it is through this. And I wonder what the next artist that's going to get that kind of AMC deal is going to be. Because it's like there's very few artists that could command that type of contract.
Yeah. No, you're right.
And Taylor's getting, from what I hear, she's getting a lot of points off of that. She's seeing a lot of the money off of that $90 million, which is insane.
Yeah, no, I mean, I can't wait for the music industry to figure out how to make more money from that. Like, oh, that's too much in the artist's hands right now. We can't just be paying licensing fees.
Because again, like you're going to see them, like $90 million, you're putting it up against like some superhero movies that come out, some like big budget movies that come out. And this movie probably didn't cost more than $15 million to make. Just off of just cutting the footage together and shit like that. The access probably costs a lot, but it probably didn't cost that entirely too much to actually do this.
Yeah, I'd be curious to see the financials behind it. And when it's all said and done, I'd be curious to see how much money it made. I just like it because it's opening up a new revenue stream for artists. I think artists have, they are making less money from the music.
Yeah.
And they just need to figure out ways around it from the merch to the rights and all this other stuff. So excited. You know, just as someone who works on the business side of music, it's always dope to see, you know, another revenue stream open up.
Yeah. Yeah. I kind of want to see the Beyonce thing.
I'll definitely see Beyonce just because I haven't seen the actual show live.
The tickets sell out? I think the tickets might have sold out for like that first couple of days. But I'll see it eventually. I got AMC A-list. I can
Me
see
too.
It.
Yeah. I'll see that shit eventually.
I can see whatever, baby.
Yeah, man.
I would love to hear your guilty pleasure.
My real answer is
Christmas music. All the Christmas.
Pat Harry's House on repeat.
Sweet Creature.
Daydreaming.
Harry Styles.
I listen to a lot of Rosalia. You can be sad, but being sad in Spanish is way worse.
All Sade records. Sade.
Shake It Off, Taylor Swift. Banger.
Anything by YG gets my Friday night turned up.
Is This Love by Survivor. Powerful 80s. Get in the car. That's the first song that's on right now.
Speaking of movies, before we get out of here, you know, I gotta hit you guys with another one, bro.
What you got for us?
Another Halloween hypothetical.
Oh, what we got, man?
Y'all ready? So I saw the new Exorcist movie.
Okay.
A couple weeks ago.
I saw the preview for that, and I was like, I don't know if I want to see this.
It's not the worst thing I've ever seen, but it's also not a good movie.
Okay.
So it's pretty much, it's fine. I label it as fine. So I was wondering, right, if y'all was in some type of Exorcist situation, are you just going to kill the kid or are you just going to, like, you know what I'm saying, try and do the exorcism?
Because
that's like, exorcism is some real shit. Like,
yeah.
You see your kid head turning backwards like that. He's spitting out green shit saying, I'm going to fuck your mom.
If you kill the kid might haunt you.
The demon kid.
Yeah, so okay. I've always been like, I don't want to just kill you, and then I still got to deal with you. Then I got to figure out another way to kill your spirit.
But my thing is this. After the exorcism, could you ever look at that kid the same? Because I done seen you say some wild shit. You've been like, have you ever seen the original Exorcist?
Yeah.
Where she's stabbing herself with the fucking, with the cross.
My thing is, like, is the kid the same? Do you ain't got no wounds from spending your neck all around and shit?
Yeah.
What's going on with your neck? Is the skin stretched out?
Like, I would never be the same. Like, I won't say kill the kid, but, like, maybe send him off somewhere. Like, you can't live with me no more. Like,
I'd definitely send the kid off.
Like, I don't know if I could really vibe with the motherfucker anymore after that. Like,
yeah.
The vibes would be off. The vibes would be off after the exorcism. For sure.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I don't think I could live with you after that, especially after I'll be seeing people eat funny, and I'll be like, I ain't gonna ever eat with you again.
Who would you get to do the exorcism? Because my first choice to do it would be Snoop Dogg.
It's funny. The first thing that came to mind was like Creflo Dollar.
Creflo Dollar would not come to do an exorcism.
What about Kurt Franklin? I mean, it'd be good. He'd probably make a good song, like a dark gospel song.
He wants you to. He would want you to pay him in sexy drill to stomp. He would want you to pay him in Bang Bros passwords.
Come on, sure. Chill out, man. Well, if, I don't know. Like, I would have someone that's entertaining to come do it. Snoop would be a good one, but
Snoop
I think
would be
Snoop
a good one.
Snoop, I don't know if you. I mean, shit. What are you, man, oh, you know what? I get to do it.
Who?
The Archbishop Don Juan.
That would be. What would he bring? Some hoes?
Hey, make that shit fun.
Because in the movie, like to do the exorcism. Okay, in the movie, it's two girls this time. So like that was like they're upping the stakes in 2023. It's two exorcism. They got to do it at the same time because their hearts are like the demons got their hearts beating at the same time. So like if one girl dies, the other girl dies, and that's like kind of the whole story thing here. So the main character is a black dude. And so, like, this might seem a little racist now that I'm, like, actually saying it out loud. They get people who practice, like, voodoo, like Haitian
religion. I was going to say, hey, that's not a bad idea.
They get them. They get Christians. They get Catholics. And they get them all to team up to do the exorcism together.
Shit.
So it's like the religious
All-stars.
Avengers.
The voodoo lady probably got it right.
She like, got it rocking. She was the only one that was really
boil
like
boil some garlic and some tomatoes and start throwing it on her.
She put some of the boiling water in the in like a bowl. She said, go throw it out to the right of the house. You got to go to the right though. It's got to be like to the west of the house or some shit. So he pours it out. Like she was like doing all types of shit, like burning the sage and all this. I was like, bro, this what were they actually studying this voodoo shit before they did? Is it working? And it was working. It's like they put that, she put the water on their head, and then like when the sweat came off them, they poured it out. I was like, bro, like they really kind of got the like. I thought the exorcist part was the least interesting part of the movie, but I liked the Haitian part of it.
Huh.
Like it was cool how they did it. So like when I'm thinking about my own exorcism things, I might want a voodoo practitioner there because they got some cool ass rituals.
Yeah, no, I fuck with voodoo. I was just in New Orleans
a couple weeks ago,
big
a month ago.
On voodoo culture.
Yeah,
that's just real. It works.
Can it kill a demon though? That's my thing. Cause when you hear about Haitian like voodoo, it's like it's about raising them, not about killing them.
I don't know, man. I don't know.
Like Mark, exorcism situation. What you doing? You've been real quiet over there. I need to know your stance.
I already know what Halloween brings. I already know what these things entail. I'm gonna just say shout out to my Zoes. My Zoes got me.
What did your Zoes got?
My Zoes got me.
Okay, the demon gonna have wicks.
Oh man,
wick demon. I mean, you could just go to Jacksonville for that. You don't really need anything crazy for that.
Kodak Black to do the exorcism would be fucking great.
Do it while smoking a black and mild.
Kodak Black to do the fucking exorcism would be legendary. Okay, like I think the demon would be scared of him. To be honest,
hey, they've created the. I mean, they have created the culture. We talk about spooky themes. Kodak. No Flocking ends up being one of the more spookier rap records of the past decade, I'd say.
Hey, we could get Plies. I would bring Plies in. I bring Plies, Kodak.
Why is Plies there?
Plies believe in God.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
He looks like Kirk Franklin.
That's actually not a bad
I would accept him over Kirk Franklin because I already know this is the man who made Sweet Pussy Sad Day. Okay? He can make Sanctified Sad Day. All right? I'm just saying, bro.
Could be it.
Reverend Run, I'm not calling him. I know a grifter when I see it. I know when you bought that demon killing life and when you not, bro. Reverend Run will probably not show up in that house.
Is Reverend still a reverend?
He should be, right?
I mean, is he like have a church?
Oh, I don't know. That's a good question. I haven't heard about him in a long time.
No, I mean
he was cursing crazy during Hip Hop 50. Is he still a reverend?
I mean, but you can curse as a reverend, right?
No.
Can you?
Curse words are curse words, man. They're not sins.
Mace had to stop just so he could go back and start cussing again. He had to relinquish the cloth.
Mace still a reverend, ain't he?
No.
No, he's not.
No.
I mean, I know he'd be on the show, but I don't think he got church, but I don't think he's still a reverend.
He's cussing up a storm on the show.
What you used with me when we met Mace, remember?
Yeah. Bro, funny story, okay?
I got a Jesus chain. Like, literally said Jesus.
Funny fucking story. Me and Josh was in a studio with Wally. And then one day, it was just the most randomest thing. Mace shows up with a bunch of chicks. It was the strangest thing ever.
Crazy.
Jesus chain, bunch of chicks. And he's just sitting down. Like, I can't even remember. I don't even know if you do, Josh, like what he was saying. He was like giving Wale some game. And like Wale was like really like kind of like paying attention to it. I cannot believe you remember that, because I completely forgot that you met Mace.
Yeah, that's me. Mace is one of my favorite rappers. So when I met him, I was like, oh, shit, this is Mace.
So he was just sitting on there like giving game, like talking about how his contract. I know he talked about his contract.
He's definitely talking about his contract.
Yeah. Because it was when he first kind of came back, Mark. It was like when he first kind of got back in the public eye. And he was kind of talking about just like, oh, this is the stuff that happened with Diddy. And you got to make, because this is when I think Wale was between labels at that point. I think it was after Atlantic. So he was like, you got to make sure the deal's right. And da da da. And he was actually giving some, from what I understood, some pretty good advice. But it was just so funny to see him there cussing still with the Jesus chain on.
That's all I'm
like. So it's like Mace's Good Music era.
No. Nah, this was 2017.
Oh, a little bit later. Yeah, a little bit later.
It was like 2017. But it was so funny that we fucking saw Mace, saw a lot of people at that point. I remember going to, yeah, that Mace shit is weird, Josh.
I just remember.
I'm fucking blown away.
I remember how the girl looked and everything. Came in like this short hair girl.
Yeah.
She kind of cute.
And he was writing rhymes and shit. I was like, this was awesome. Okay, Mace, we'll do my exorcism.
Yeah, that's not a bad one.
Mace, we'll do. He'll dance.
Are you kidding me?
Remember the dance of When Money Were Problems?
Mace is already well prepared for conflict after the story that he told this past week. He said Big passed and Diddy dipped and left him.
He was hiding.
I couldn't believe that. I could believe that story, but I couldn't believe that story when I heard it.
So okay, Mark. So you asked the Zoes to help you with the exorcism. Josh, yes. You said Creflo Dollar. I'm telling you, Creflo is going to be in the Escalade. Like, yo, y'all handle that shit. I'm not doing that shit.
Or Don Juan. Bring some hoes.
Darwin would definitely walk in just to see what was going on. But I think afterwards, me and that kid's relationship is done. We can't vibe no more. We're done. I can't do it. But I got one more good Halloween hypothetical. I'm going to wait till next episode to do that.
Okay.
I thank you guys for walking with me along with these crazy ideas. If you listen to the show, what's your premier exorcist lineup? Give me your top five, your starting five exorcists.
Oh, man.
Speaking of which, have we got any closer on our Halloween episode of the BlkPrint?
Niggas want us to be.
We have not. They want us to be ninjas.
They want. Well, what if we get the masks from Halloween 3?
I'll get the blood one, the blood mask.
The scream. Can you even find one of those?
The scream mask everybody has.
Don't come to my house with the scream mask with the blood, bro. Don't come to my house with the scream mask with the blood, bro. That's a demonic fucking concoction. But we got to think about this, because the next episode we do is going to be right before Halloween.
All right. Well, let me think on it. But I ain't.
I'm gonna get a fit, and I'm gonna welcome you with the fit on.
This guy. Oh my god.
I could have got the weekend after hours fit, but it's too late now. It's not gonna come out for Halloween.
Well, you got to get something.
Yeah, you got to get something. You
should be Jimmy Butler with the emo suit.
Oh my god.
Oh, and get the hair.
Yeah, and get your eye pierced.
Nasty.
It's too much work.
Somebody said we gaslit Mark last episode.
Oh,
because you said that he had to shave his mustache so you would dress up, but you don't gotta like cut anything of yours or shave anything.
What does gaslit mean nowadays? Who said that? Gaslight. Yeah, I think it's just use that shit for anything now.
I'm gonna shout out Tim though. Tim said, "How y'all gonna tell Mark cut off his
That's
beard?
That's what he said. It. That's
to,
what he said.
To be belly and five is gonna be sub zero with dreads."
That's what he said. All right, I said I could be Cyrax from the game. I would be Cyrax then. Fuck it. He got dreads.
Oh no, man. I gotta think on this some more. Maybe I'll just be Larry David. I got the mask.
I mean, you could be Larry David, literally.
Yeah. Let me think on this some more. But dressing up is just. Maybe I'll be Rich Paul.
You look like him today. Nobody the wears Rich up. Paul. Listen, nobody wears Rich Paul clothes but Rich Paul and Josh. The only two niggas that wear Rich Paul clothing is Rich Paul and Josh.
Hey, man, shout out to Rich Paul, man. Class.
That's it, bro. That is it. But listen, we'll talk to you guys in a week for our final episode of BlkPrint Radio. We're going to get the B-sides really quick. We're going to talk Drake. We're going to talk about all of the discourse surrounding that album and the sexy drill of it all. We also have the episode of Throwblacks. We're recording that next week. So it's going to be all right before Halloween. 3-6 Mafia, Most Known Unknowns. Make sure you go check that album out. Go stream it. Be ready, because we will have questions and quizzes for you guys when it comes out. And yeah, thank you guys for listening to BlkPrint. For Josh and MC, I'm J5. We'll see you guys in a week. Make sure you check out. BlkPrint Radio, last episode. BlkPrint Radio, last episode. Make sure you check it out. I want to have 1,000 listeners so that they won't shut the app down.
Oh, man. it ain't enough.
Oh, my God. See you guys next week, man. Shit. Peace.